Now, decades after the Vietnam War, some private universities are taking a new look at ROTC. NewsHour correspondent Spencer Michels reports.
Stand up.
If students at Stanford in Palo Alto, California, want to join the Army's Reserve Officer Training Corps, they have to come here to Santa Clara University, 16 miles away, to attend class.
Carry on.
Stanford, like many private schools, severed ties with ROTC 40 years ago, pushing it off campus, a situation that could be about to change.
If you're going to become an Army officer, you have a type A personality. So you're all leaders.
In the 1960s, with the Vietnam War raging, students and faculty at universities across the country made campus ROTC programs a target of demonstrations and demands. The mood was anti-war and anti-military. At Stanford, the ROTC building was burned down. Ann Thompson is a Stanford senior and a cadet battalion commander in Army ROTC.
I think that a lot of the reasons that it wasn't really popular in the Vietnam era aren't really applicable to the debate today.
I think that the general mood on campus is that people are just really, really excited to learn more about the military, especially with just the increasing role in foreign relations.
The seven Stanford cadets at Santa Clara get no credit for ROTC classes, but most get their tuition paid, plus a monthly stipend and transportation between campuses. Nationally, nearly 500 ROTC units have crosstown arrangements with nearby universities. But those arrangements disturb cadet Jimmy Ruck.
By not having it on campus, it's precluded many students from even participating.
You could set up your assaulting team as one entire squad.
One reason Stanford kept military training off campus was the military ban on gays. Then in 1993, Don't Ask, Don't Tell barred openly gay people from military service, including ROTC. Now, with its repeal, though it's still not implemented, the debate has returned. Harvard was the first private university to reverse its policies that kept ROTC off campus. Stanford and several other private colleges are debating the issues. Public universities, for the most part, did not ban ROTC, fearful of losing federal funds. At Stanford, the debate has been intense, but unlike the 60s, polite. It began when former Secretary of Defense William Perry, who now teaches at Stanford, and others proposed bringing ROTC back into the academic fold.
Having the mixture of the ROTC students with the rest of the students was a good thing, I thought. It was important for the Stanford students to be exposed to the people who are going to be our future military leaders.
With the U.S. military engaged in at least two wars, Perry is concerned that students at elite universities have become isolated from the men and women doing the fighting. Barely a handful of Stanford students have enrolled in the military in the last few years.
We want the citizens of the country to have something to say and to participate in their army. And we want not just the citizens from the lower ranks of society, but the citizens who are going to the elite colleges.
Despite a slight rise in college graduates entering the military recently, the numbers remain low, especially at elite schools like Stanford.
We've got a submarine captain who's being court-martialed because he hit a passenger vessel.
History professor Barton Bernstein, here teaching a seminar on nuclear war, was a young anti-war faculty member in the 60s who was active in demonstrations against ROTC and is still fighting against it.
The course of ROTC is still dubious. The faculty would presumably be chosen by the Pentagon and not by the university. And I have moral doubts about the presence of ROTC. It's primarily teaching people how not simply to lead, but how to fight and kill.
Education professor Eamon Callan is a member of a faculty committee formed to consider these arguments. He wonders if ROTC limits open inquiry and impinges on academic freedom.
Suppose you have an instructor who's teaching a course in international relations and decides that as a class assignment, they will invite students to analyze some documents that have been made available through WikiLeaks. They're still classified documents, And a student in ROTC might jeopardize their future security clearance if they are required to examine one of those documents as a course requirement.
But William Perry is more concerned that the military be able to include in its ranks well-educated Stanford students.
They ought to be leaders, contributing to leaders in our military field as well. It's part of our country, it's part of our democracy.
Professor Bernstein, who was a cadet in the 1950s, says that true leadership is not the kind they teach in ROTC.
Does leadership mean element, column, left, column, right? Shoulder your rifles, parade, rest? If that's leadership, it's not something I think we should be teaching. If it's leadership with critical judgment, they're barred in part because they're not allowed to criticize the commander-in-chief.
Do not debate tactics or techniques with the leader. If you're asked to give input, then give it. If not, don't.
ROTC classes are at least as rigorous as regular classes, argues the chair of the Department of Military Science at Santa Clara, Lieutenant Colonel John Tao.
I think it's probably even more stimulating and more academically challenging than the regular courses.
But for an anti-war group putting up posters on campus urging students not to support ROTC, the issue was militarism.
It would change the character of the campus because it would be a U.S. military facility on our campus.
Sam Windley, who heads Say No to War, was one of several students of varying opinions we contacted. Autumn Carter edits the conservative Stanford Review.
The idea that this campus is still stuck in the Vietnam anti-military era is just completely absurd. It is in Stanford's interest and it is in this country's interest to put the best into the military, to have them not only educated, but also trained here.
Trans rights are human rights!
Like the anti-war students, gay groups on campus also oppose the return of ROTC. They say the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell didn't go far enough, since it still allows discrimination against transgender people. Liana Keyes is active in Stanford Students for Queer Liberation.
Because ROTC does not admit transgender students, it does not admit intersex students, it's perpetuating that discrimination.
Student Association President Angelina Cardona thinks the military's exclusion of transgender people will play a surprisingly important role in Stanford's decision on ROTC.
I'm personally pro-military. My stepfather is a veteran. I would be thrilled to see the ROTC return to Stanford University if they were willing to meet us halfway and to include all of our students in their organization and in this unique opportunity. However, as it is now, they do not.
Cardona helped prepare a non-binding online student vote on the ROTC issue. 44% voted in favor of ROTC's return, 17% opposed it, and 39% abstained. But it's the Stanford faculty that will probably have the most influence on the administration's decision on whether to bring ROTC back. The faculty committee voted Friday to recommend bringing ROTC back. The full faculty senate meets Thursday. If it and the university president agree, the Pentagon must then decide whether to establish a Stanford military science department.